I'm here today with Dr. Jeremy Schmoe from the Functional Neurology Center, and we are going to be talking about brain health after brain injury. Welcome back to Hope Survives Podcast, Dr. Schmoe.
Yeah, thanks for having me. Excited to be here.
Absolutely. I'm excited to have you. And before we get into the conversation, I wanted to let everyone know that we are doing a free webinar called Brain Health in Concussions and TBI/ABI. And that is happening April 17th, Saturday from 2 to 4 p.m. Central Time. So that's 3 to 5 Eastern Time. And it's completely free. You can sign up at the Brain Health Online Summit.com. Dr. Schmoe and I are going to be hosting it together. We have a panel of amazing experts, and this kind of the precursor for the Brain Health Online Summit, which is going to be happening this summer. So Dr. Schmoe, you want to tell them a little bit about that?
Yeah. So, I mean, this summer we're going to have probably between, 10 to 15, just really amazing speakers in the traumatic brain injury world, but also performance enhancement, nutrition. We're really going to dig into how you can help the brain just be healthier overall and improving, nutrition, gut health, hormone health, visual health, vestibular system, what you can do to get back into exercise. So I'm just super excited about it. I think it's going to be great.
I'm excited too. So that information is thebrainhealthonlinesummit.com. I will put that link in the description. So I wanted to let you know about that. If you're listening to the podcast right when it releases, you'll be able to check out the webinar. It'll be this Saturday. If you're listening to it later, no problem if you missed it. You could go on the website and we should have the playback options available at some point.
Yeah.
But if you come live, you can participate in the Q&A. So, all right. So let's go into it. Brain health after brain injury. So I'm a TBI survivor, as everyone knows. And for me, learning that there are things that I can do to help the health of my brain has been a game changer. Because when you have a brain injury, so much feels outside of your control. Like your symptoms are outside of your control. It's like you don't want your brain to do something, but it does it anyway. It's like really frustrating. So learning some things that I can actually do to help my brain has been huge. So Dr. Schmoe, where would you like to begin when it comes to what are some things that people can do after they have a brain injury to help their brain health?
Yeah, I always say that. I mean, one of the number one things that we need to do is to help get people out of pain. So, I mean, if you can decrease your pain levels, I mean, that's going to be huge for being able to get into doing the rehab that you need to do, like, vision training and, vestibular and working on your balance. But if you have a constant 10 out of 10 headache and your head feels really full and pressury, and your neck feels just, painful and your shoulders hurt and everything hurts. I mean, there are some things that you can do, at home to hopefully try and decrease your pain. And one of the things that I highly recommend is Prologel. Have you heard of Prologel before?
I think you showed it to me, right?
Yeah. Basically it's a cream that you can apply topically to the skin. And what it does, I'll just keep things simple. It goes in and changes the pH in and around these nerves that are like subcutaneous right underneath the skin that can be leading to a lot of pain. So there's something called neurogenic inflammation that when you get these injuries, these nerves get hyper excitable. And by applying the cream into those nerves, it can take that firing rate and just decrease it. And if you can decrease that pain, then you're going to be able to function better and, go and do the rehab that you need. So some common areas that I like to apply the gel into are, so you have a spot like right here, it's called Herb's Point. And from here, it actually has a nerve that like crosses. So some people will feel some like pain or, changes in their throat. But the nerve also comes up lesser occipital and it'll actually give you some like ear fullness and pressure. So a lot of times people will be like treating up here, but if you actually treat down here and apply the gel here, you'll see this pain start to go away.
So for those who are listening, so we have a video version of this on YouTube, but for those who are just listening to the audio, can you describe where it is?
Yeah. So if you go, so you have your ear and then you have your clavicle. And if you go halfway between there, more towards the front part of the neck, you'll dig in kind of through those scalene muscles, and you'll feel kind of a little tender spot, and there'll be some tender nodules usually in there. And that's where these cervical plexus nerves actually like branch out, and they go up to the ear, but they also go back to like your scapula. They go into the clavicle. They can actually, some of them loop up and go around the ear. So if you treat that front part of the neck that gets whiplashed all the time, you'll see some improvements in some of that kind of searing, like thoracic scapular pain that you might have. Everybody knows that. You go and you touch like right about here and you're like, oh my gosh,
on your shoulder.
Like on the shoulder, it feels horrific. It feels gross. But if you actually treat Herb's Point and apply the cream in through there, you'll see some improvements in all these other nerves that are kind of distal away from that area.
Wow.
All right. And then, you know, getting up into the occipital nerves, greater occipital, that'll give you some pain that actually like loops up around the head here. All right. That can also give you some oral fullness, some fullness in the ear. And then actually just taking the cream and actually treating, you have supratrochlear and supraorbital nerves that come up here above the eyebrow. And these actually like loop up. So people will feel some like tender, kind of maybe weird spots or sensations in their scalp. But if you just gently apply the cream in through there and do that about 2 times per day, and I recommend that people do it for a month. And then what that will do is actually take those nerves and just decrease their firing rate, so they're not just firing spontaneously and leading to headache pain.
Wow.
So that's something simple that we can do. Another thing is you really want your autonomic nervous system to be in balance. And a lot of times after head injuries, people go into this kind of constant fight or flight mode. So you're easily startled all the time. And really what we want to do in many cases is improve your parasympathetic tone or your vagal tone. And one of the things that we recommend is actually just gargling. So basically take water, back of the throat, you're going to go back and you're going to gargle until you start to feel yourself start to tear almost. And when you have that going on, basically, you know that your brainstem is starting to get activated. And hopefully what that will do is kind of calm your nervous system down, bring your heart rate down, bring you into more of a state where you just feel calmer and more relaxed. And if you can get into that state, then what will happen is then your nervous system will just not be firing so high, and that should hopefully decrease pain. All right. So those are like just two really, really simple strategies of, you know, application of Prologel, gargling, and then just working on your sleep, just like sleep hygiene can be really helpful. So, you know, really trying to stay off your phone, you know, right before you go to bed, decrease that blue light, you know, meditation, working on your breathing, maybe using essential oils prior to going to bed. Just some of those things can kind of get your brain into more of that relaxed state and keep you out of that fight or flight mode. So if you can, you know, start to sleep somewhat better, decrease pain, and improve your autonomic function, that's really going to help put your brain into a state where it can start to heal. And your brain's inflamed. So there's a whole bunch of cellular stuff that's going on. So your brain's inflamed. And your neurons are firing at a kind of like almost like a spontaneous rate. And some areas of the brain are starting to almost like hyper communicate with each other. And that's where some of the symptoms just get to be weird. And another thing that we can do is actually take magnesium threonate. That can be really helpful. Magnesium basically goes into the cell, goes into a receptor, and it can kind of calm down some of the neuronal hyper firing that's going on. And that can be really helpful if you do that prior to going to bed. So there are things that you can do nutritionally. There are things that you can do kind of structurally to calm pain down. And there are things that you can do to help your autonomic nervous system kind of get into a mode where you're not firing so excitable.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you for explaining that. And especially after concussion or brain injury, like what you said, the brain is inflamed. Mm-hmm. So it's like, when we have all these symptoms, that it just feels like it's random, or it mm-hmm. feels like it's unpredictable, or it's like, you know, you never know how you're going to feel the next day or what your brain is going to necessarily do. But understanding like, well, there's actually this point of inflammation that is affecting your brain. So reducing inflammation, like you said, through nutrition, but the sleep thing, I think that's huge. How many of us just stay on our phone until we go to sleep?
Yeah.
Right? Stay on our phone in our bed and scroll, or, you know, read on our phone. And reading before bed is great, but it's probably better to read on a book, or I found a Kindle Paperwhite.
Okay.
Is really great. The Kindle Paperwhite has, like, the screen is not, it has no blue, it doesn't have blue light coming out of it. So it looks like paper. I mean, you can turn up a brightness, but it has an option to have like a tan-ish background with black text or a black background with white text, depending on how you're feeling. But you can change the font, you can change the size. Like, reading after brain injury was really hard for me, but the Kindle has really helped.
Very
There's
cool.
a font called Open Dyslexic on the Kindle that is designed for people with dyslexia, but I've actually found it helps my brain to process the letters a lot easier.
Yeah.
Just because of the way the font is designed. And so I put it on the dyslexic font and I increase the size and I keep the brightness low. And I've actually found that I can read for pleasure again.
Awesome.
You know, and so, you know, there are things, but like thinking about before bed and sleep and being on our phone, like, if you want to get better after brain injury, we cannot afford to be careless with our brains. Like, we just can't. The way that maybe you were before your brain injury, or the way that other people, like, they might know that their sleep is going to suffer if they stay on their phone, but they really don't care. For us, like, if you really, really want to get better, a simple thing you can do is stay off your phone 1 hour before bed.
Yeah.
Or 2 hours, you know, if you want to really calm down your brain. It will help. I promise you it will help. There's so much research out there about it. But there's a point also where you have to decide, like, am I going to prioritize my brain health, or am I just going to keep living my life just random, trying to stay afloat, you know? And I'm not saying that, you know, sleeping better or not being on your phone is going to fix all your problems. There are still going to be days that you feel like you're barely floating with your symptoms. But the things Dr. Schmoe is sharing, like the suggestions, it doesn't hurt to try.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, and the thing with the phone too, I mean, it might not even be the light that's coming in. Sometimes it's just the scrolling, the motion, the movement. I mean,
that's a good point.
Brain injuries and concussions, I mean, they affect your visual system, so they can affect how your eyes are steady, pursuits, so following objects, moving eyes quickly, motion. So it could just be the visual motion and the movement that's exciting your brain as well. So, you know, people need to get specific rehab exercises to do and have a very specific protocol of things that they need to do to help get better. But the things that we just shared there, I mean, anybody can do that. I mean, those are just really, really simple, easy strategies. You know, for the most part, that they're not going to make you worse. They're just going to make you better if we do it. So,
yeah, they're low risk things, right? It doesn't hurt. So what are some other things that help the health of your brain?
Yeah, I mean, so right away, it's just taking out all the inflammatory foods as well. So inflammatory foods, anything in a can, you don't want to drink pop. I mean, basically, you want to drink water. You want to stay very, very hydrated. Maybe add some lemon into the water. Work on your body's pH. Cutting out gluten, cutting out dairy can be very, very helpful. You know, taking out any foods that you know that you're just that are inflammatory for your system can be helpful. You know, we're talking about neurons and we're talking about glial cells in the brain and we're talking about inflammation in the brain. So decreasing these foods that are inflammatory can just be super helpful. And then just working on basic exercise. We had an article in Experienced Life magazine. Maybe we could put that one up there where it just goes through some simple, just like cross court exercises, some different figure eight motions and movement. Your brain loves stimulation, but it doesn't want to be overstimulated. So just using the body in very specific ways can help kind of activate some of these circuits in the brain and make them more stable. So, you know, we don't want you just looking at dots and just shaking your head all over the place right after having a concussion. So using your body is a really, really good way to help kind of activate some of these networks in the brain. So doing different types of movements of the arms and legs, working on just walking, you'd be surprised on how just working on a normal walking pattern can be very helpful for your brain. And all that information's in the article. I think there's like 5 different exercises, and it's just so simple to do. So if you added that in, you started gargling, you worked on your gut health, you worked on taking out inflammatory foods, you worked on your sleep, maybe take some magnesium to help calm some areas of the brain down. You stay off your phone, you don't scroll as much. If you just start adding those simple strategies in, I would say that that's probably going to help you get better.
Yeah, that's great. I will put the link to that article in the description of the podcast. I also want to put a link to the Prolo gel. So if you can send me a place where people can find that. So I'll put those links in the description as well. But yeah, you know, when you talk about movement and exercise after brain injury, there were a number of years after my first TBI that I really struggled with walking. Mm-hmm. It wasn't actually until I saw you a couple years ago that I actually could walk without struggling. And it was like, I didn't even realize how bad my autonomic system was off until it wasn't anymore. I'd just gotten used to it. But I remember feeling like every time I would start to get sweaty. So like if I'd go on a treadmill or if I would try and do some exercises, as soon as I would like my heart rate would go up and I'd start to get sweaty, I felt like a band was being squeezed around my head.
Yeah. I mean, that's hallmark dysautonomia. So dysautonomia, there's multiple different networks in the brain that can get affected with concussions and head trauma that can lead to changes in the way that you get blood flow up to your head, and your brain just wants to get blood flow to it and wants to be able to function. So if you're not getting that perfusion, that blood flow to your brain, then obviously that's a problem. And there's so much complex circuitry that helps you get that blood flow when you go from seated to standing. And one of the things that people don't really take into account is how important your vestibular system is. So when you walk, like even when your foot hits the ground, like your head has to move. So if your head is moving and your eyes aren't doing what they need to do, it's going to change the way that your foot hits the ground. It's going to change your stride length. It's going to change your step. And improving that and improving your vestibular system can actually really help with headaches. It can help with getting better blood flow to the brain, and it can help you feeling more stable when you're walking around. So when you start to exercise, you won't go so dysautonomic, meaning, you know, maybe your blood pressure drops or your heart rate goes up too high, or maybe you exercise and your heart rate goes up, you know, really high and your blood pressure goes up high. There's all these different things that can happen, and there's some different therapies for each one of those. And I think we talked about that during our dysautonomia.
Yes. If you guys go a couple of episodes back, I forget what number it is, but Dr. Schmoe was on. He did 2 episodes in a row, dysautonomia and the vestibular system. So if you're interested in learning more about those things, you can go back and listen to his previous episodes here on the podcast.
Yeah. And they, you know, they've done some research where they'll take like astronauts who have been up in space and then research their systems when they come back, and they have changes in their autolithic central vestibular system. And they have all sorts of weird stuff going on with their heart rate and their blood pressure and their ability to like get blood flow up to their head. So if you injure your brain, if you injure some of those vestibular pathways, that can lead to some, you know, some interesting changes in your autonomic function. Okay. So if you're trying to exercise and it's just not going so well, you know, doing some vestibular training specific for you could be really helpful. And then another thing that I see is when people try and get back into exercise and they just feel horrible, usually they have something going on with their gut. All right. They might have, you know, small intestinal bacterial overgrowth, something inflammatory going on GI. And when they start to exercise, they just get this almost immune related response. So those are kind of 2 big things that I've seen is really bad GI system, which can actually develop after TBI. And the dysautonomia, all right? There's something called the Buffalo treadmill test and the Buffalo bike test. It kind of goes through, you know, what your heart rate should be. So if people Google that and look that up, that'll give you some good advice on how to kind of get back into exercise more graded. without pushing your system.
That's a great, great suggestion. I spent like 10 years struggling. I had no idea. I didn't know I had dysautonomia until you identified it. I literally had no clue. But I would, because I looked fine, right? And I didn't have any like visible deficits as far as like, you know, visible disability. I did have muscle atrophy on my right side initially after my TBI, but that it seemed to even out or stop after a certain amount of years. And I felt, you know, I thought I was fine. Like as far as physically, I knew my brain was off, but every time I'd exercise, I just lost heart. Like I would get so disheartened and I just stopped trying. And before my brain injury, I did sports. I was a dancer. Like I was very active. And so I just like stopped trying. And you know what's interesting? I cut out gluten last summer and I've been dairy free. And since I've been working on things in my gut and since we've addressed some of the dysautonomia things, now I actually feel better after I exercise, not worse.
Yeah.
You know, I'll go on the treadmill or I'll do some simple exercises and I can get sweaty and I feel better. I feel good after I exercise. And you don't understand how horrible I used to feel. And so it's like, I can vouch for you guys listening that I understand that trying to exercise after your brain injury can be really hard, but when you address the health of your brain, it can get better.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I would say that getting back into exercise is one of the things that it's just the hardest for people because you want to go do the things that you used to do. And sometimes you have to like kind of step things back a little bit and maybe work on, you know, being able to hold a lunge position or just hold a squat position or get your muscles activated. You know, there's these routines that we develop for people. It's kind of like just like a nice flow of what we think their system can handle and tolerate. And we try and work them from basically being able to move around on your back and not get dizzy and then do some exercises on your back, like different like core stability training, working on like deep neck flexor strengthening, neck extensor strengthening, and then move up to being able to do some things seated. And then move to standing and then move to walking and then move to running. So we always try and see if we can't progress people on that, you know, moving from basically on your back, being super dizzy, can barely even move, and see if we can't get them moving, walking faster, running and being able to jump. That's always kind of my goal. That's is to awesome. Get people back to that. And it, some people you can progress through really fast. Some people it just takes longer if you have that autonomic dysfunction and if your neck is just really, really bad. So if your neck is whiplash and it's painful, there are things that you can do to help with that. So like I said, decreasing pain has been huge for our people. Getting you out of pain and just improving how your neck feels helps all of your rehabilitation work so much better.
That's awesome. Yeah. And it's not just like exercise for the sake of like, oh, exercising or being an athlete. It affects your daily life, like walking around the grocery store, right? With all the stimulation happening around, if it's hard for you to walk, if it's hard for you to stay standing and do that, like I've experienced that when I was in college walking to class. So I went to a very, very small school, very small campus, but it was an older school. So one of the buildings didn't have an elevator. So I'd have to go up stairs to get to one of my classes. And I remember every time I would arrive at the class, my heart was beating so fast every time. And I'd sit there and I'd be out of breath. And my heart was like racing every time I'd get into class. And I didn't run. I didn't, you know, I wasn't in a hurry. Well, sometimes if I was running late, but, you know, but simply the act of walking to the building and going up the stairs caused me to feel like I ran a marathon. And I didn't, I had no idea. I didn't even know dysautonomia existed. I didn't know what was going on. I just thought I was out of shape. I just thought, like, I thought that happened to everyone. Like, I didn't know that it had to do with my concussions and my brain injury. Like, I just thought, like, that's what happens when you're out of shape. And I kept feeling like, oh, I really need to get in shape. And I had no idea that it was my nervous system.
For sure. You know, and I've had patients where, you know, they work out, they can do everything like seated. They can go on like a, you know, a recumbent bike and they can just pump like crazy and go do work. But as soon as you get up standing and they're trying to like walk and run, it's just lights out. And I've seen some patients where literally you get some specific eye movement better, or you take away some drifty motion of their eye, and then they can just literally move from recumbent bike to like walking and running within like a week, which is really, really crazy to think. So, I mean, your system is, you know, we're pretty fragile as humans when it comes to our autonomic system and like what our system can handle when these injuries happen, but you can get things better and become more resilient and, you know, get back into physical activity, hopefully. And there's just a lot of improvement that can happen if you get specific with what you do.
Yeah. So if you were to say one thing in a nutshell, brain health after brain injury, what would you want to tell people?
Number one for me, I mean, it's decrease inflammation as much as you can. I mean, you can do all of the exercises, all of the things, but if you don't change, you know, staying hydrated, changing up your diet, working on gut health, like there's no way you're going to be able to get to where you want to be. I mean, you can decrease symptoms, but when we talk about just full life function, like you have to decrease inflammation to help you recover from that brain injury.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, that's great. Thank you so much for coming back on the podcast today, Dr. Schmoe. And I'll put your information, the Brain Health Summit information, and some of the things we mentioned in the description below. And I hope you guys can join us at the spring webinar. If you happen to be listening to this later, you miss it, join us for the Brain Health Online Summit this June 2021, and hope you can make it for that as well. So,
thanks for having me.
Yes, thank you so much. We'll see you soon.
Bye.